Okay guys, we'll get started. We are lucky. We have, Savita Wakhlu here. Earlier we had Prat Wakhlu. The reason I say we are lucky is that it's seldom that we would have somebody who is a motivational speaker, executive coach, an author. Many of you know that we give very high value to some of the soft skills. Here with us is somebody who is an engineer by training. She has a degree in engineering, in mechanical engineering. She practiced that. She first taught at her alma mater. And then she moved to these other activities. We know through our own experience that these speaking skills, presentation skills play a very, very important role in our success. So for us to have a chance to get some tips and advice and learn from the experience from Savita is extremely valuable. She is a managing director of Jagriti Communication and focuses on wholesome individual and organizational learning. Savita and Bharat is an example of multifaceted individual, highly accomplished, made good impact in a lot of lives. So there's a lot for us to learn from. I won't take a lot more time. You guys all have read her bio also. Savita, so thank you very much for coming here. This is just wonderful opportunity for us.
Thank you to you. Thank you to the Lois Center and thank you to the Wright State University and each one of you for being here. Presenters and communicators honestly have no value till there isn't an audience. Do you agree with this? So if I was in this room all by myself doing the show, as they say, and you weren't around, so what was the big deal? So most essential part of the whole process of presenting is the people, is the audience, the group that is keenly, attentively listening to you, trying to listen, but you have to do your bit. The area of presentation skills, as everybody would say, is vast. So we have an hour and then, of course, question answers. So I have chosen to really pick up the nuggets that I think will be useful to you in your own ability to present effectively. So at the end, when we have questions, feel free to ask whatever. But in between, I might be just, involving you a little bit. Is that okay? Okay, wonderful. Start with a story. The stories are amazing. I was in middle years in India, and we come from Kashmir. So I was in one of these presentation convent schools. So when my mom came to get my report card, and the teacher said, she knows it. She knows it. She can't express. Okay? My mom couldn't understand. She said, if you know, just express. I mean, it's as simple as that. But it wasn't as simple. So over the years, when I shifted gears from the technical arena to the soft skill and training and coaching and development, I realized presentation skills is something that needs to be learned, honed, improved, and developed. And this is one skill, while I have been doing a lot of training in different areas, this is one skill I really swear by, because in the course of 2 to 3 day training programs, I see like a 360 degrees change. On the first day, the participant says, I'll speak later. And on the second or the third day, the same participant says, can I get a few more minutes? Because we have gone through the process very systematically. So this is a thing that if I practice, like some of you like playing soccer or tennis, I love cooking, so I make errors, then I learn again, then I burn something and I realize the temperature was less. So this is really a continuous journey. And while I was thinking what to call the session, I know this was a study done by Chicago Tribune a couple of years back, that what is the worst fear we as humans have? And you saw the abstract? It starts with that line. The worst fear is fear of speaking in public. Then death and incest and fire or whatever. But the first one is fear of speaking in public. And for a long, long time, I thought it was the language. So if you come from a country where English is not your first language, it becomes difficult to just think through the message and then quickly make it into a language which is, you know, accepted, which is English. It's not the language alone. Language is important, but not language alone. So, another story. I have been in Rotary for many, many years, and Rotary is a service organization. We had just founded a new Rotary club. Just within a few months, we had a visitor. And if you are in another country, anywhere in the world, you can attend a Rotary meeting and you get attendance. So when you go back to your club, you show them the attendance, so you're marked, okay, you have 100% attendance, whatever. So this person came in, I don't know from which country, and I don't want to name that. So he's there and we say, tell us how Rotary functions in your country, please. So our president, the founder president, was a woman. She said, please, sir, you've come from a different land. We are new in Rotary. How are projects done? And this guy said, oh, some other time, okay? I said, a veteran Rotarian can come up and tell us, what's the big deal? But he didn't do it. So for that day, my takeaway was, it's not just the language. You may be fluent in a certain language, it's not just the language, okay? Third story, I was teaching a course at one of the business schools in India, and the course was Art of Public Speaking. We had to go through 2-3 rounds of presentations and I would evaluate them. And this young lady, on the first time I called her number, we had to draw out little numbers, her roll numbers. She said, I have a sore throat today. So I said, okay, next class, not a big deal. Next class, I don't find her there. So I asked the friends and they said she wasn't too well, so she skipped the class. And this was the major part of their evaluation. So I offered to her, it's a small city where we lived. I don't know, some of you from India may know Jamshedpur, Tata's hub. And Bharat was working with Tata's for almost 30 years. So 18 years we were in Jamshedpur. So I said, you know what? I'll drive to the college, and this institute is called XLRI, which is management business school. So I said, I'll come to the class, we'll find an empty class, you present. So if I would give you grade B, I'll give you B minus because you didn't come on time. I mean, you didn't come when you had to do it. She never obliged. So I feel bad because she left the university, the college, with the thought that she's not a good presenter. And she escaped from those opportunities she got as part of her coursework. So my thought here, which I want to reiterate, effective speakers are not born. They are really people who have worked and reworked and, you know, like embellished their ability to speak. And nobody's a perfect speaker. We are all work in progress. You believe this? But there are some star speakers, like Steve Jobs, famous when he introduced the Mac on his beautiful big platform. That's considered great. Or we have Martin Luther King, or we have President Obama, so no politics here today. So I normally used to show his videos. But anyway, what I'm trying to say, there are some people who come forth as very effective, but please go back and dig deep and ask them, were you always like this? The answer would be, no. I have really put in a lot of effort. Do you all agree with this? Okay. So now with that context, that somebody in school could not express herself, did put effort and was important for my own work that I chose as a facilitator, as a trainer, I had to be working on it. And I still feel there are some aspects where I still need to be at it. So it truly is a continuous journey and it is doable. So at this point, if I asked, and be honest, if I asked that how many of you can get up and make a presentation, how many of you would do it by a raise of hands right away? Any topic.
Wrong or right?
Wonderful. But others are like, I can. Okay. And the reason you said, I can do it, where did that confidence come from?
I don't know, maybe years of practice.
And you can do it.
Not only presentation, but you can feel this this feeling when you talk to your friends, when you talk to groupy or friend, party, anywhere. So you have some confidence the way you can talk.
So
I believe.
So you do pick up opportunities even in small groups and where the threatening factor is a little low. With friends, you can just say whatever. But you realize that you sometimes become the leader of the group because you try and take over that little command. When you do it in smaller groups, you can do it for a bigger groups also. That's okay. Anyone else like you did? It was like halfway. What was that halfway? Where did it come from that I can do it?
Depends on the topic. Depends on the knowledge of the topic.
I said whatever you want to speak. Right now I said whatever.
Oh, yeah, but why? It's just like, I'm just afraid that people would not have patience to listen to all.
Okay. So the people who didn't raise their hands came from many thoughts. And we will look at what those thoughts are. If speaking is a beautiful ability we have as humans, why is it that we avoid situations where we have to address people in big or moderate groups? What is it? I mean, we're human. We speak. We're not like animals where the responses are fight and flight. We have the faculty of speech. Okay, so let's start. Another little story and then we move on to a few slides. Oops, okay. I need help. First time today. Yeah. Oops. Okay. And why do you think pilots aren't afraid?
Experience.
They have experience in what? Experience in?
Flying.
And they have the tools in their hand. They have all the controls in their hand. How many of you have seen Sully? You did? Did you see what he did? He landed on the Hudson River and all the controls. It was a crash situation, but he actually... So he wasn't scared, he actually landed on the Hudson River because he had the skill. So in your Hudson River experience where you are with the group presenting, if you know how to take care of the controls and the tools, you can land safely. Okay? Do you agree with this? It's really, really true. Honestly, it is like, thank you. Thank you so much. So this is it. So today's thing, I leave you with this thought. Presentation skills are learnable? Yes. You improve them by practice and experience? Yes. Your anxiety is really dependent on how well you prepared? Yes. Can you look at others and as role models and pick up some positive traits? Yes. But can you emulate and con others? You come with your own distinctive style of communicating, presenting, reaching out. Can it be an enjoyable process? Yes. It comes with so much of joy and satisfaction when you reach out to people and they get back and there's a beautiful symphony. But a lot depends on the one who is standing on this side of the fence. So speaking in public, fun if we do it more and more. So this was what I was referring to as the pilot who is not scared. Why? Because the controls are with him or her. You don't have to be pinned down. The moment they say, tomorrow is presentation day, docs, post-docs, oh my God, what do I do? How do I present? Whatever. It doesn't happen all the time. I'm just dramatizing. The many concerns all of us have, but a few of them are, as our friend here said, how can I get them to listen to me? Will they listen to me? Yeah, that was something you said. What did you say? You said something, the apprehension. What did you say it came from?
Saying that they may not have a patience to listen
to me. Listen to me. So how can I get them to listen to me? That's what I think. Why am I so nervous? Of course, you're human, your emotions. That's it. And how can I keep their attention? So these are the things that as a speaker, I I think or we think. Okay, let's move to the next one and then I'll tell you. And what are they thinking? Okay, what are the listeners thinking? This is broadly what they want. This is broadly where they are. Enter my mind if you can. Know what I want, okay? And be prepared with that. That's one. What do I get out of this? Why am I sitting here? I'm giving 1 hour to you. Can you leave me with something as a takeaway? Otherwise, shut your shop, okay? What do I get out of this? Please speak my language. And because you are amazing in your technical domain knowledge, many times it happens, and this may not happen with you, we try and bombard our audiences with so much of tech stuff that they get completely floored, and you have impressed them. Do you know how much I know? Oh my God, impressive. Did you reach them? Maybe not. So are you communicating to impress? Then go on that track. Or are you communicating to express? If you want to express your ideas, your information, please, please, please speak the language they understand. And while I'm at it, I just have a thought that comes to my mind. When you are making presentations across cultures, be very sensitive to the language, the jargon, the abbreviations, the phrases that you use. What you thought I know in this country, my language, many others may not follow. So if you ask somebody, what is your marketing technique? And somebody says, I just did a dog and pony show. And then I heard it the first time, I said, what is a dog and pony show for marketing? I didn't understand. So when you are communicating, speak the language and the others really understand, whatever you're saying. Give them something to remember, make it easy to understand, keep it simple, and of course, convince me or don't waste my time. It sounds harsh, but that's the way it is. So let's move on to something. Every communication begins with an idea. You first think about it, you comprehend it, you plan it, and then you go and deliver, and then you go and speak. Even when you're talking to your friends, let's go for a movie, it first came to your thought. Let's go for a movie, guys. Sully is on. Okay? That's an idea. Pick up a phone, call your friends, send an email. The medium you use could be anything, but it starts with a thought. So always, 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 clarity of your idea is most essential. And of course, this person says, we appreciate your business. So yeah, that's an idea, okay? I call this the ABC of communication, and I'll introduce you a few of these things, and then we get them out of the way. I'll come back. Okay. The ABC, accuracy. And because you are in a highly technical research area, the accuracy of information that you have created needs to be super, super, super duper. You can't afford to make those little errors because there's this amazing network that you create and you're giving this data to other agencies, you know. So accuracy, and then the second one, brevity. I was talking to somebody yesterday and I said, I'm going to speak at the Wright State University at their center. I said, tell me one thing that I should share with these really postdocs and docs, and they know so much of stuff. He said, just one thing from my side, and he works at GE, aviation, I think, yeah? Somebody I know. He said, there is too much information sometimes people share, and it's not needed. If somebody asks you anything, you have a backup, or you have a hyperlink. They want to know, click that. They want that additional thing, go to another slide. Give it to them as a handout. But please don't inundate your audience with tons of material. Do you agree with this? But there's a tendency. I've done it. Yeah, I need to tell them what I've done. Curb that tendency and keep it brief, brevity. But brevity is not at the cost of accuracy. It's accurate, it's complete, but it's brief. And the last one, clarity of thinking. You think clearly and then you have clarity of speaking. And speaking is everything with the vocal thing, the voice, the pace, the pauses, the pronunciation, the vocal aspects, okay? We then go to what you call Kipling's. He introduced 5 serving men. And what are these 5 serving men? The 5 W's, actually. The first one is, why are you communicating? The most essential piece of the pie is, what's the objective? Why are you communicating? What do you want to people to go back with? Okay? And then take it diagonally there. Who are listening to you? Because you will draft your entire content. Our daughter is in the process of revisiting, applying to different social enterprises, whatever. She has to keep on writing cover letters. So she's tweaking every cover letter depending on what the organization does. Otherwise, the same cover letter would be okay. But no, who are you sending it to? So the cover letter has to be tweaked a little bit. The same way you are speaking what you are an authority on. But who are you speaking to? You need to transform that. You agree with this? So many, many years back when we didn't have YouTubes, we didn't have, what else, where do you get your videos? Google, YouTube, what other do you have videos?
Vimeo,
of course. When we didn't have that, we had these big VHS videos from a different generation. I mean, we are the aliens, yeah? So I used to get a lot of these from the library just to get myself into the frame of speaking and whatever. There was a video which said, speaking 1 to 1,000. That was the video. And they showed the speaker speaking. We didn't know who the audience is. And he's speaking about nuclear fusion and nuclear fission and stuff like that. And suddenly the camera is moved to the audience. And the audience has little children aged 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever. What do you think the audience was doing?
Playing.
Pushing each other, sleeping, whatever. Why? He was talking what he knows the best, but he could have made it very simple and understanding for the people he was talking to. And the objective of that video in that piece was, who are you speaking to? So transform it, lighten it, make it more glamorous, depending on who you're speaking to. Okay? And then what is it that you're going to step? The content. The content, as my daughter said, it's not the content, you know, so we still call it content, sorry, content. You need to know what the content is. And then, of course, when is it happening and where is it happening? This seems so irrelevant. But the first time I was actually attending a workshop with somebody who was into training, so I was more like an apprentice. The training is happening tomorrow, and in the evening he says, I need one trip to the venue. I said, why? The training is tomorrow. Okay, like a naive. He said, I need to see the place. Why? I need to know where the controls are. I need to know where the lights are. Where's the exit? Everything. So that I know the setting before they know it. So if anything comes up, I'm comfortable with it. So where is it happening seems so irrelevant, but relevant. When is the time? Is that the right time? If it is the afternoon, can I do some activities so that people are alert? So essential, Kipling's five men. I call these the three V's of communication. You know it. I've just given it the name of three V's. And what are the three V's? Verbal, vocal, and visual. Everything you say as far as words are concerned is verbal. How you structure it comes in verbal. Everything that happens with the word and the phrases and the content is verbal. All that happens with the voice from, as I said, the pace, the pauses, the pronunciation is the vocal aspects. And the last one, visual. Whatever people can see. Okay? And you can see right now I'm sweating. I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay? Nervous? Not really, but excited. Yeah. So everything that happens with the body is the visual, as you can see here. Feel of confidence, formal dress, firm handshake, correct posture, gestures. Everything put together makes it a total beautiful package. If you want to go through this quickly, I just breeze through this. The last one, which is how do you do it? The five W's are in place. Why am I communicating? Who am I communicating to? What is the content that I want to get it across? When and where is it happening? But the last H, which is how do I do it? These are those things. Maintaining eye contact, having the right body posture, which is confident. And it will be confident if you're confident with your content, with your material. You don't have to tell your body, okay, be confident today. You know? It will happen. If you know your stuff well, you will come forth as being confident. the gestures, I just want to make one little point here. Many times we feel that the body must communicate too, so people use extra gestures, you know. Dramatic. It doesn't have to be dramatic. And your gestures will be natural. When you know your stuff, your hands will move, your body will move, your face will convey, your shoulders will convey. Please keep them natural. They don't have to. And when we make presentations, the most tough thing people ask me in workshops, what do we do with the hands? Okay? It's an extra burden. So one thing people do, they hang them by the side. And when you hang them, they move back and forth. They have their own mind. The second thing I see people when they communicate, they just save themselves a little bit, you know, protect themselves, and they close. So when you see a posture like this, what happens? And a speaker is talking to me like that. You don't like it. It's not an open posture. Yeah.
But somehow it's body language, right?
Yes.
Connected body with what we present.
Absolutely. So if you keep your body protected like this, it comes forth that you are not open to them. You're not open to others. You've already closed yourself. So what do I do with my hands? Okay, let me put them at the back. And this we call, this posture or this thing, we call as parade rest. You do parade, in a parade, parade rest. Again, my hands aren't available, so I can't use gestures. One more posture that people have, what do I do with hands? They just put it in front of this, in their body. And this posture is called the fig leaf posture. What does that mean? In some part of the times immemorial, people will use fig leaves to protect themselves. So it's called fig leaf posture. What do I do with my hands? I still have them. So many people rest it on their stomach. Oh, this is a very safe place, the resting ground. Yeah, and if you have a little bit more flab, then it's a beautiful place to keep it. And you must have seen people doing it. The easiest thing to do with your hands is just put them in front of your body lightly. Just put them light, relaxed. You want to do this, you want to do that. You want to use them, they'll automatically unlock to express your ideas. So the simplest, use them, but don't overuse them with stuff happening, okay? Facial expressions, obviously warm. Enthusiasm, enough to excite your audience. Not enthused to the point of disrupting the whole, making it chaotic, but enthused that I am here with you and I'm here for you. And once that happens, even if the speaker makes errors, you actually, what's the word? You forgive them. Because they built a beautiful rapport with you and they came forth as being very, very enthused and happy that they are with you. Unnecessary mannerisms, it happens when we are nervous. We could use anything and I have a pointer and I could use the pointer because, you know, I'm nervous. What do I do now? Okay. I could do this. Many people fiddle with their wedding or engagement rings, or I've seen people doing this to their glasses, or people rubbing their noses, or they have a belt and fiddling with the belt. The easiest is pick a pen and start fiddling with it. Is there anything wrong? No. Why am I saying avoid them? Because people love watching your interesting mannerisms and they forget that you are speaking something. Isn't this interesting when people do this? When is the next time it happens? Okay, we are waiting. So unnecessary mannerisms, be aware about them, and as you move on, you drop them slowly. But many of us do have them. That's because the speaking part is not an easy thing. So when you hold on to something, it feels more secure. And you like that security, like your security blanket that children have. They go with the pillow or the blanket everywhere. Why? Feels good. It's my security. It's okay. The volume thing, we just quickly breeze through this. It's a pace, pauses. The essential component of this is the tone and the modulation. Many times the content is with you, but you are delivering it or speaking at a tone which is... if you sing or if you know how to modulate your voice, you understand the relevance. So when there's an important point or important content, you... certain punch to it. Yeah? Do you get what I'm saying? Some intonation, varying the pitch and modulating your pitch helps tremendously to grasp people's attention. And of course, pronunciation, unfortunately, when English is our second language, many times the pronunciation gets little you know, out of hand. So I'm trying to say something, but the person understands something else, because that's the way I said it in my country. So last night I was with this family. The wife, I mean, they've been here 21 years. So she said, we have tortoise. I think in India we call it tortoise, tortoise, whatever. And the daughter said, it's not tortoise, because that's the way we called it there. I don't know. She said tortoise or something like that. So we do, I mean, it's tough. And the first time I was in US 13 years back on a train, and my daughter was hungry, so I wanted to have a, what do you call it, P-I-Z-Z-A?
Pizza.
So I must have said pizza. I don't know what I said. So he said, I don't understand. So my daughter said, Mama, she had started going to school, so she understood it better. So when she said it, he got it. Yeah? So be aware when you're using some words, are you saying it the way others understand? Because otherwise they go in a different direction and you lost them. Okay? And of course, fillers. Fillers is something you use in between. They're like ahs and mms and, you know, what I mean is, you see, what else? Give me some more interesting ones. So I had one participant many years back in a training, a senior executive, and he said, you see what I mean? So it kept on happening. You see what I mean? You see what I mean? It was a beautiful dance we were doing. On the last day of the presentation, you'll not believe this, this had almost evaporated because he wasn't aware. He's saying, you see what I mean? You see what I mean? Why do fillers happen? Why do you think fillers pollute our presentation?
What?
Intention. I mean, it's not comfortable.
To what you're saying?
Yes.
So you're not sure what I should say. Should I say?
Yes. It's the way to think it.
Yeah.
That period of.
So either one is not completely clear as to what you want to say. So you are saying and thinking together. That is one reason. Number two, the hold on the language. So till I get the right word, I have to do The best thing is be silent. If you're looking for the right word, that silence doesn't hurt, but the ahs and ums and ees, not hurt really, sorry, that's a strong word. What I'm trying to say is that keep them away, wait for the right word to come, you know? So that's the fillers. Do they really, are they like no-nos? No, it's fine, don't worry. It doesn't have to be perfect. You can still make an error. What I'm sharing with you is that it does happen that many times we are completely unaware. And one of the groups, somebody came up and said, do you know how often you use honestly? I had never noticed it, never. And she said, in a whole two-day workshop, do you know how many times you said honestly? I didn't know, but she knew. So what I'm trying to say is be aware what those fillers are and where are they coming from. Is it the lack of clarity of the subject and your thoughts and structuring of the thoughts? Or is it that the language is a little bit of a concern? So once you know that, it's easy to take care of it.
I think there is another type of this.
Yes.
The use of the word like. And the Americans use it so much.
What is that?
You know, it's like.
You know.
I know you.
I know, like.
Young Americans.
Young Americans. Young Americans. I'm like, so when we came to US in 2003 and my daughter started in a few months, they pick up. She was just 9 and a half. I'm like, I said, you know what, hold your English language, what you came with, because this I'm like, again, is something you don't know what you're saying, it has become more like your habit. And the more it becomes habitual, more difficult it is to get it out of the kitty, you know. So a few words that I wanted to share with you, when you make presentations, people find some words more persuasive. And these are the 12 most persuasive words, and what motivates others. And please take a look at that, I can tell you what they mean. When you talk to people about saving, they like it. When you talk to people about safety, when you talk about proven, easy, so I see products in Kroger or Stop and Shop or whatever, new. Is that really new? I don't know. But do I buy it?
Yes.
When it says 33% more, do I buy it? Same price, more. So anything which people put there, saving of money, yes. some result that if you use this anti-blemish cream, and at certain age you want to look for anti-blemish creams, and they say in 7 days it's been proven and the results are there, and another one, discovered. It's now been discovered why blemishes happen, and I want to know why, you know, pick up a product or whatever. And the most essential word there is you. When you include or involve your audience and you use that you more instead of saying I, it works better. Yeah? You want to, when you talk of guarantees, people like that. When you talk of health in today's world, people like it. So if you are using in your presentation anything which you want people to be inspired, you could use this. Yes.
Do you find that it's the concept that's important or the particular word itself that is important?
The use of word in line with what you are trying to communicate. I'll tell you something interesting. There's a word there and nobody asked, but it's funny, but I when I discovered what it means. When you are in the selling world, and I have been selling whatever bit of work I've been doing on my own, when you tell somebody that so-and-so has it, or so-and-so did this program for their middle-level executives, would you like it? Many times people say, yes, we do want it. Why? Because somebody else has it. Yeah? You know what I'm saying? So if your center has created something, and now somebody else wants to talk about it and put it forward to their management, they can refer. So in this institute, Noesis Center has already done it. So then the other center says, oh, they have? Let's do it. So when you are trying to motivate for any kind of decision and you're presenting research data, if you use any such information which gets people's emotions sell a lot. Most of the ads are really catering to our emotions and they make a fool of us sometimes. Yeah. So emotions, if you can get people, not in a negative way, I mean, not because you have to say it, and it should really be you involving them, and when you involve them, you give something, you share something that interests them or has any of these benefits, it does reach across better. Yeah. Most essential part of my presentation today, and we will spend a few minutes on this. The next slide that I'll take you through, which is these two are the meat of the presentation today. Why do people feel anxious or nervous? And that was something we wanted to demystify today. It's not because somebody speaks good language. It's not somebody because somebody is very charismatic or looks good and has a good voice and, you know, husky, whatever. It's not that what sells. It's the amount of preparation the person has done which reduces their level of anxiety. Do you agree to this? And we normally talk about this as an iceberg, that 1/10 of the iceberg is what people see in that lecture of yours. 9/10 of the iceberg is how much time did you put in preparation? Yeah? And what does preparation mean? I mean, what goes into preparation? There are a couple of things that I have put there. There are many more, but I didn't want to inundate you. So just a few points I want to leave with you. First and foremost, making a presentation, you have to commit to yourself that I want to reach out to my group. Many times I hear speakers, they say, you know what, done it many times, let's just go and talk to them. And believe me, people realize that you haven't put your thoughts together. You haven't committed to this presentation. They just come and show up, as they say. And I know this, my husband tells me a lot, Bharat, whom you met, many of you met. When I have a training program, which I've done many times or something, I'm still preparing. And he says, you've done it so many times. Like that. But I don't feel comfortable. I have to spend a couple of hours, if it's a shorter thing, a couple of hours, to actually go through the whole thing in my own mind. Structure it, plan it, prepare it, anticipate questions, everything. Prepare the audiovisuals, yeah? So please appreciate that you are presenting to people. Commit to your own self. I want to make it a success, okay? And that's the next, that's the nervousness thing, sorry. A positive attitude, yeah. You can't come like, you know what, Amit just told me to talk to you and okay, I can talk. I'm half dead and I'll make you all die. That's not the purpose. The purpose that I take it seriously, and it's a serious business, not serious, a sincere business. And I'm here to reach out to you, a positive attitude. Know all the facts about who is there, about know the audience and know all the facts, and know yourself also to some extent. Not to the point of getting self-conscious. So when Bharat said, there'll be a recording, so face the camera, do this, whatever. So I said, oh my God, I'll tell Amit not to record because I'll get a little conscious or whatever. So know yourself, what bothers you, hassles you, leave the camera, just focus on what you have to say. And of course, analyze your audience. How many? What is the demographics? What do they know already? Why are they here? And everything. The ratio of women or whatever. Everything. And most essential, in your preparation, organize your thoughts and structure them in a way which people can understand. There's a huge thing on how to structure, which we'll leave out today. But there is a method to that entire process. And you could use any of the methods that you are comfortable with. So structure your thoughts, organize your thoughts, and prepare your notes. There's nothing wrong in having a index card. You know what index cards are? Small, thick cards. They shouldn't be of simple paper. And if you're in a country like India, where the fans are full blast, your papers run away, you run behind them, you know, you don't want that to happen. So a material like typical index cards you get in US everywhere, the index cards need to be really pointers. It's not your whole content. It's really pointers, okay? If you have two or three index cards, just number them, because sometimes you're looking at the right, you don't know which index card went where. Number them so that you know one, two, and three. If you speak very fast, somewhere in the index card, you can write in red color, go slow, so that you're looking at it, go slow, okay? And you have trouble maintaining eye contact, right somewhere, eye contact, then it reminds, okay, eye contact, yeah? So it's a beautiful aid that you can use, index cards. If not, today you have presentations, it's a great way of actually having your notes out there. You can use anything. You can use mind maps or whatever method works for you to organize yourself and prepare your notes. If you're giving a handout, how well is that made? Is it a shabby piece of paper? I told you about I shouldn't have said which college, but anyway, when I was doing this course at the business school, I realized each of their slides, they were OHPs. Do you know what OHP is? This generation, overhead projectors. We didn't have so much of laptop business then. So overhead projector, they had slides, the acetates as we call them. I sit at the end of the class and had 60 students. And each time I'm straining to see what's showing, and I realize every slide was so full. Some of them had done a good job. So when I asked, I said, why are your slides so full? They said the acetates are expensive. And we have to make for every subject presentations. So we want to save on the, obviously. So I understood where it was coming from. But please prepare your notes that you can read them, others can read them, because you're trying to reach them to somebody. For my students, I could understand. Anticipate questions. This is one way of reducing your nervousness. If you know what kind of questions will be posed to you, you feel more confident. So prepare and plan. Does that mean you have all the answers? No. You can say, I don't know, and I can get back to you. But you don't need to have all the answers. And of course, plan your audio visuals, what you're going to do. And the last, not the least, rehearse, rehearse, rehearse. When we came here, my daughter started playing this double bass, that big thing, you know. So she, poor thing, was this much, but she was holding that. And the teacher was an amazing teacher at her middle school. And he said, Sampada, you need to practice, practice. She said, yeah, practice makes it perfect. That's what we used to say in India. He said, no, practice makes it permanent. I liked it. So the more you rehearse, the better it is. Now, do you rehearse like in front of the mirror? Go ahead. Do you rehearse in front of a few friends? Fine. What do you have these days? What do you use these days? Selfie? No, you can't rehearse for selfie. I'll tell you something, another story. When we had to make our final presentation in our engineering coursework, all of us were scared. Everybody. And it was being evaluated. So we had a group of four very close friends. And one of them said, guys, are you scared? Yeah, I'm also scared. Let's do one thing. Let's pick up an empty classroom and let's present. And each one who presents, the other three will raise a ruckus, will be obnoxious, We will call names. We will make you feel most uncomfortable. Let's do that and be prepared. So we rehearsed for a couple of days, and the other three, while one person spoke, the other three were horrible. Whistle and throw aeroplanes. So that we are actually rehearsed and ready for the final group of 100, 150 people or whatever. Does that make sense? So rehearse, never goes wrong. Please put your attention on this, and this is what I want to leave you back with. Because we were talking about enjoying speaking in public and making presentations with ease and enjoying the process. And the only challenge or a roadblock is the anxiety that comes. Domain knowledge, your expertise, your knowledge, you are perfect. And you know your stuff inside out. At your level of academic excellence, I wouldn't know what you're talking about, honestly, because you have given so many years to it of learning, of developing, of studying, of researching. But the only thing sometimes that can become a deterrent is the anxiety. So what do we do with that anxiety? Very simple. It's so simple that you feel that's it. So the first one, prepare thoroughly. When you fail to prepare, you are preparing to fail. When you fail to prepare, you're preparing to fail. Simple. So yesterday I read something that Dalai Lama, His Holiness, said. If you lose, don't lose the lesson. So if you make a lousy presentation, remember what the lousy part was. Yeah? All of us are doing that. So anyway, visualize success. In your own mind, imagine that when I do this, it's going to be a star presentation. Because if you visualize, what's the opposite? Defeat or
failure.
I like the word in America, I'm a loser. I mean, this is such a strong thing we use, and we say to ourselves, I didn't do a good presentation, I'm a loser. It's not a big loss at all, honestly. But please visualize that you will do a great, great job. And I know this may sound funny, but when you are psyched up in a positive way, you put in that effort to make it go well. And if you're psyched up the negative way, oh my God, I've never done it, I've always failed at presentations, I'm not good at it, I'm going to lose my grade, whatever. It sets in a very negative, like a vicious cycle, which doesn't help you. So visualize all is going well for you for that day. Focus on relaxing and whatever works for you. I don't know what relaxes you. You want to put in your little headphones and listen to your most beautiful, soothing music. You want to listen to whatever, a motivational talk by somebody before it. You want to go and fetch yourself a cup of coffee. If you have learned yoga and you can relax all your muscles in some way, sitting down there and doing it, most essential, take a deep breath and just breathe. And find out what relaxes you. Do that. Whether it's a chat with a friend, you call a lifeline, call your spouse. You know what? I'm really stressed out. Okay, honey, don't worry. It'll all go well. It always goes well. Whatever. So you are feeling good. Whatever your lifeline is, whatever relaxes you, do that. The next point may seem funny, that how can I maintain eye contact? I'm nervous. I don't want to look at people. But this may really sound not true, but it really is true. When you try and escape from maintaining eye contact and you look at your whiteboard and then you look at this whiteboard and then you look at the plants and the ceiling and the ground, does it work? And you look at people, you realize how human they are. They're like you. They're human. And they'll forgive you if you make some goof up. But don't avoid maintaining that eye contact with them. Does that sound funny? It really reduces nervousness. Try it out. And of course, anticipate questions, we spoke about this. Stop worrying about yourself. I have to tell you a little story here. Even if you're up there and your legs are feeling like jelly, you know, like, and your stomach is going roar, some butterflies, and your hands are sweaty, and your throat is dry, and you're sweating, try and not focus on that, because they don't know it. They don't know your legs are trembling. Of course, if you're in front of something and you can see the legs trembling, otherwise, they don't know the churning, they don't know the heart pounding. Just forget it and just move on. And please don't focus so much on what you're feeling. We were doing a very nice three-act play in Jamshedpur, where we live. We rehearsed for 3 months and it was a nice three-act play. On one of the days, we had to drop the, what do you call these, the content, what is it called? The script. So finally, we have learned the script and the director says, okay, today, without script, you're all ready. I forgot one line. And suddenly I said, sorry. She said, what happened? I said, I forgot one line. Does your audience have the script? But because I knew I missed a line, automatically I said, sorry. She said, the moment you say sorry, they say, oh, she forgot something. They don't know what you're going through. So just drop it. Just leave it aside, okay? And of course, if you're feeling stressed out, one of the simplest things is just move around. Move and do a little bit of, move and transition movement. The last one, I know this sounds so funny, but believe me, incidentally, I've written a book on making presentations, which was published in 2000 by Sage. This is something really is my own experience, that believe that your audience is basically a good group of people. Don't look at them as your, they are your allies. And this is what I write in my book. Your audience is your ally. They are not against you. Why should they? But if you do some stuff and you create that I'm talking to you today, and you put yourself on a pedestal, well, then they are not your friends. But when you're talking to them, they are your allies. And even if you make an error and you say, sorry, I didn't know, they're fine, they're okay. So please believe in that, and that helps you to become more easy. And finally, breathe. Okay? So I think, let me leave you with this. This is broadly what making presentations put together. Take a look, and if you have any, you want me to clarify anything, I will. This is all like the consolidated message. It's okay? Want me to explain anything? No? Okay. We'll come to the questions in a minute. Just drop this. I've just created this for something I was doing recently in India for a communications group of mass communication students in Delhi. I just created this for them, and if you want, I can leave a copy of this or whatever. I just put all that I think about impact, communicate with impact. So if you just take a quick look at this. There's all the words that I feel are essential for communicating with impact. And you can ask me, because some things are just the words, if you want me to clarify anything, but otherwise, this is putting it all together as far as my experience goes. And you can prepare your questions. It's 12, so 11 to 12 was our time, and I can leave this behind. And you are the master of the show, as it always is. And everything revolves around you, and only you and you can work on your own ability to present. It's nobody else. So after this, namaste. And namaste basically means this. I know, I honor the place in you in which the entire universe dwells. I honor the place in you which is of love, of truth, of light, and peace. When you are in that place in you, and I'm in that place in me, we are one. So namaste.
So all these sentences in one word, when you see each other, you impress in the first beginning, namaste. I thought we always is like a hi in the beginning of conversation.
Yeah.
So all these sentences in the first moment, you see somebody express yourself.
In namaste?
Yes.
Well, I'll just come to that, and I'll leave this here for you. So thank you so much for being here. Get ready with your questions. I'm available, and I'll try my best to address that. As far as your query is concerned, the logic behind namaste is a very beautiful logic, that when you fold your hands together, that's in India. Now, many times, because I do a lot of cross-cultural work, people say, does it have to be at the heart point? And there's no method or maths to this. It's basically folding both my hands, and what does that mean? My left and right brain together are bowing to you. My intelligence is bowing to your intelligence, number one. Number two, I'm not carrying any weapon. When you do namaste, you can't carry a gun. You know what I mean? Namaste is without any ammunition, I'm in front of you. You don't need to bend 30 degrees or It's nothing. It's just accepting your goodness and mine. Okay? In the India that we grew up with, when we met somebody, namaste used to be the first thing. In the South, we call it namaskaram, or you can call it anything. But in today's India, nobody does namaste. It's hello, how are you doing today? Good day. So today's India, I don't find people doing namaste. So when we do this cross-cultural training for expats, and they normally say, should I say namaste to my colleague? Don't do it. You know, as youngsters from India will, you don't need namaste in the office. But yes, if you go and visit your colleague's parents, you're going to their home, if the parents are there, you may do namaste. Otherwise, it's totally out of place, because in India today, namaste is really for closer families and all, not for the business place. Does that answer your question?
Yes, yeah. Yes. Actually, sometimes they use the same picture or emoji for that. So sometimes I was thinking, okay, is it thanks or is it same namaste or is it like a hi? So that's why when you click on it, there is no any explanation
no,
on that.
No, but it's
but
namaste.
I know that this is namaste, but they are using as a thank you,
yes,
for example,
yes,
right?
Yes. And you could use, because whenever somebody does good to you and you say thank you, namaste, automatically it happens in our culture. We don't actually do it forcefully. If somebody does something nice, you just put your hand goes to your heart and say thanks. Now, this is not a tutored thing. This is tutored over generations. But we don't tell ourselves to do it. It just happens. So if somebody does a good gesture, you normally say thank you, namaste. Yeah? Because you don't shake hands in our culture, so... Welcome. Okay, guys and girls, shoot. Yes.
Can you say a few words about how you make a classroom of students relaxed? When,
are you one of the faculty members?
Yes.
Oh. Let's ask them what relaxes you? Because your senior faculty wants to know, how do I make them relax?
Capital, I owed you like one thing that in the past you asked like one-liner joke.
I also sent you that. One-line joke.
One-liner jokes.
You say those?
Joke.
Yeah, I asked my students to volunteer one-liner jokes.
Oh, and that makes you feel relaxed? Very nice. Very nice. Couple of thoughts I'll share with you. Does anyone have any other, because this is from you and you know it the best. His query is, how do I make my students relax while we are talking about heavy duty, high tech stuff? Yes.
Always make sure you start with something that the students know. Because whenever an instructor starts with something you don't know, you have nothing to build on.
Oh, wow. Beautiful.
I have another point.
Beautiful. Did you get that? Build on something they already know and then take off from there. If you start from something just totally not, known, then it becomes totally an unknown territory. But would that relax them? Yeah, maybe otherwise you get stressed up because you don't know what's happening. Yeah.
I feel if you show yourself you're relaxed and you don't start seriously with very serious matters or serious topic, so everybody follows
feels
you.
Relaxed.
Feels relaxed. Same as you have.
I like that. She just stole my point, but I like it. I'm happy she did. When you are at ease with your group and you come from a place that I am sharing something because I know about it, but you are free to add on to my learning also. Because these are adults. You know, when I got into the world of training and facilitation, the guru who coached me in this area said, you are no more teaching undergrads at your college. They were students. They were young students. You're now going to be in a group of adults. And adult learning is a little different from that because they come with a lot of knowledge themselves. So if we harness that, if we make them feel good, you know, like, you know this, and share about that, maybe I'll also get enriched. And you create an atmosphere where there is a lot of warmth, genuineness, authentic self, and sincere. If you are sincere, your audience can sense it through the way you interact, through the way your body language, everything put together. So if you are relaxed, they generally relax. And please appreciate one more thing. You have done all your homework, spade work, good. You're on firm ground. your audience on a certain day, more people or less people, they are coming with their own mind on that day also. Don't take it personally if a group of 4 or 5 students working on a project are distracted. They are thinking about something else and you take it personally that, okay, maybe I'm not doing what I need to do. Why have I lost that group of people? You know what I'm saying? So sometimes be aware it's not just you who is getting across a message. It's also the people listening to you because they have their own mind which is working overtime and getting distracted. And of course, the last final thing for your thing, if you feel there's a distraction happening and they're losing interest, a short break, as you call it, a bio break or whatever, wouldn't harm. Just one couple of minutes of break. Or if you feel a group of people or somebody is creating a little bit of a, what's the word?
Chatter, noise.
Chatter and noise and distraction, you could actually ask those people, I don't know how it works, that why don't you, you know, take this conversation outside and then come back when you're done with it. But of course, with adults, do it with tremendous care and respect. I think, is that okay? Does that help? Okay. Did you have a question at the end? No. No, I'm talking to you.
Only, yeah.
So, yes.
Look at the smile.
Yeah. She has such a beautiful eye. She's coming with some. It doesn't have to be only a question, please. It could just be a comment. It could be your learning you want to share with us. Because one of the best things that happens in adult learning spaces, it's not just that one person who has worked in that arena. You could be sharing something which could be of great value to any one of us. And just one little thing, I know I love sharing stories. Yesterday I was on WhatsApp, and we have a group of our own family group. And I said something, and this sister-in-law of mine, she picked that up on WhatsApp, and then she responded to just my thing. You know how to do that? I'm sure you all do that. So I said, how did she do it? Because in a group WhatsApp where you have 15 people and everybody writes something, she just picked up my thing and responded to it. Then somebody else has responded to it. So it became like clear who she's responding. So I said, wow, I need to learn this. So I put on the group, hey guys, how do you do it? So my niece, she immediately said, long press that message and press reply. So I didn't know this. I mean, the youngsters, they teach us so much. I mean, I am like, I feel, wow, how can I learn all this? So please feel free right now. If you know something from your own experience or your own research in presentation tools or whatever, feel free to share. It doesn't have to be a question. Yeah.
I think the best thing that I've learned from presenting is I come before for the audience and I stand there and then, you know, it helps actually to look at them when they are entering and then I'm terrible at coming to a class filled with people I did not see them before and then presenting to them. I can.
Very nice. Very nice. You come, you're on firm kind of easy thing. You have put your equipment in place. It's functioning. I was helped today. And you feel, okay, now I'm set, you know. It's a beautiful feeling to be there before them. And do you realize that also sends a message to the people that you were here to host them before they came? When the guests are there and the host has disappeared somewhere, they don't like it. You go to somebody's home and you say, where is the host? Oh, you know what? She just went out to fetch something. It could be okay in some cultures, but some cultures don't like it. They want the host at the door and say, welcome, you know, namaste. So please appreciate being there before them helps you tremendously to be at ease with your space, with your equipment. And as they walk in, you just gauge, okay, how is everybody, you know?
Yeah, and
thank you so much.
This is very brilliant, you know, the excellent technique. And suppose you are, let's say, giving a talk at your company, and you expect, you know, some senior people in your audience. You are there, they come in early, you have a chat. That can be fantastic because, you know, I think you immediately impress that person, right? The other thing is, as you already said, it shows that you value their time. It shows that you are willing to put in more time rather than you are lord, they're coming, you know, and, you know, giving them something. There is something right here which Savita did that shows that she cares for the audience. She personalizes and prepares for that. What is that?
That's what?
Oh.
Right, because she could have easily come and just presented her standard thing, not put in. She doesn't know. She has given this talk many times. She doesn't have to prepare for this or make any change. But she did that, right? And that gesture, it's visual. It's not in your face kind of thing, and yet it conveys, right?
Well, one thing that you
sure.
and I really like, and it works for me.
What's that?
Every time. That is like before any presentation, I always feel like nervous. It's not like I'm scared or anything. It's just like my heart just beating so fast.
Oh, you come in, put your step
foot. It's always there.
Oh my God, yeah.
It's always like that. And then even like in the classroom or at a conference, like everywhere, I feel very nervous. Like when I look down and I say, okay, I just cannot hold it anymore. Just like very scary. But then, like, the thing that I did was I took a very deep breath, like two or three times, and then go down. Then after I started talking, it goes away. So that's really
very nice. I'm going to build on that. I'm just going to build on that a little bit. Build. I'm going to build on that. Breath is an amazing connection with our own self. So when you're meditating, if some of you do, or you're chanting, or whatever you're doing for your own well-being and joy, you realize breath makes you realize if you are stressed, your breathing is shallow. You realize your breathing is just here. When you're stressed, it's here. When you're relaxed, it goes down to the abdomen. So when you're on a sea beach, enjoying, or on top of the mountain, or with your beloved, whatever. Of course, with your beloved, it could also be like this. Sorry, wrong point. So wherever you are, whenever you are at ease, your breath is very, very deep. But the moment you sense that because of this little anxiety of, sorry, presentation, and your breath is, a little more stressed, number one, be mindful of this. The first and foremost, be mindful and accepting. But if you start fighting with yourself, why does it have to be prepared, whatever, that fight doesn't help you. The first and foremost, be mindful that I am really, really stressed. My heart is pounding. I can feel it. I can even see it, like whatever. Be mindful and be aware as to what is happening. And then do the deep breathing, yoga breathing, deep breathing, abdominal breathing, whatever works for you. But breath is an amazing way to connect with your feelings.
I have one more question.
Sure.
When you're giving a technical talk, you know your audience.
Yeah.
You know half of your audience knows about your topic.
Yeah.
And the other half knows the general area, but not too many technical details. And the colleague from your area, they want more technical details,
yes.
More specific details, but the other part is not. How do you handle those kinds of situations?
I'll tell you what I think, that we can ask others also. If it's a very heterogeneous kind of a group with varying amounts of experience in that area, it is a challenge. First of all, how come they're all there together? That you have to question. Can you break it up into two groups? Or can you use the experience and the knowledge of the people who know it in some way where you're doing a group work, or you put some people, diverse groups together, depending on what kind of format you have in a presentation. If you can't do it, you cannot afford, if it's a major chunk or percentage of people who don't know what you're going to talk about, you will have to start with that basics. And believe me, the people who even know about it, and that is your little, oh my God, they already know. What am I telling them? Nobody minds a reminder. Nobody minds that you are being told something again. And if you present in a way that even uses their experience, and you can always include them, if somebody has done so much work on that area and you are just getting into that space, please feel free to tell that person that would you like to comment, or because you know about it. But in a way that you're not telling the person, now is the time to see how much you know. You're doing it in a way genuinely that person, that group knows about it. So use their skill and experience, that's number one. Do something where you are getting them together, if you can. If not, then start with the basics. Always start with the basics, because I like what's... Oh, she's left. Because she said that if you start from something we know, it always goes off. And then you can take us for a because when you take off, you're always at a little lower level. I mean, you can't take off like this, you know. So you cruise for a little while and then you go to the higher heights. So start from the basics, so that always works. Or build a ground where everybody is with you.
I think you can acknowledge that some of you may know some material, and but she made a wonderful point about acknowledging them, perhaps involving them, you know, then I think you've taken away, you know, their feeling that, oh, I'm wasting my time, kind of thing, you know, so, right?
And if you do ask somebody and he says, oh, no, it's okay, then don't push it too much, because that person doesn't want to share it, let it be. Because if you push too much, then that person gets cornered. The purpose is not to corner them, the purpose is to include them, so that's the difference.
Is many of my friends, so let's say if they're preparing for like a serious talk, mm-hmm. like a chat talk, a presentation talk, or any serious talk. So they say that usually you write a script
mm-hmm.
and memorize them, which I'm thinking, should we do it? Because it was sounds like a machine if we just read what we have written, right? So in the presentation, we want to show the enthusiasm, right? So if we just memorize and try to remember, I think like we may lose that. So what is your take on this one?
Let's leave this. This is what I put together, I thought, because we don't have much time. I didn't go there. Now that you're asking about it, this is it. Please don't memorize. Don't memorize every word. You're not going to do that. Then you come like you're parroting it. You don't want to parrot it. So don't memorize every word. Number two, be realistic. Come forth that you are a real human being. You're not a robo, like a robot or whatever. What you should memorize are the stepping stones, the main points. And put them down on a note or something, but don't memorize the whole thing. I don't know how many of you have gone through this. At one point in my life, I used to, in a small community where we were, a lot of school competitions, and you judge children. And you're there sitting as a judge with three other judges, elocution. And these little kids come up and they have prepared their piece, and you know. And suddenly they say, and the whole thing goes for a toss, because they have memorized it, you know. So for young children to forget that line and just to walk away crying, that I've seen so many times that I stopped judging. Because as my children grew up and they would come home and say, I didn't do too well, I won't get the prize, whatever, I realize that I don't want to do this. It's not a very objective business, so let me be out of it anyway. So your memorizing should be of which are the main stepping stones, not all the content. Because if you forget one thing, then you've lost it. And of course, the index cards we spoke about, mind maps, write a script but edit it, and use a memory hook because that helps you on the journey. It's a lot like the stepping stones. And rehearse, if possible, with somebody or just loud. So this is how you can, yeah. Anything else? Anyone? Because I just want to wind up with one little story. Any question? Any remark? Any suggestion? Yes.
One thing about that. How do you forget what you are going through on that day, or you have a problem just before you go, want to do? Like these big people, like you spoke about Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, they're present, but they have huge problems, like financial or family problems. What do you do? Like if you don't concentrate, you will lose everything.
Yes, very nice, beautiful. Did you get the question? Because then we can ask some others, what do you do? This is a very, very nice question. That if we are there in a presentation, but something is looming on our head, personal, professional, financial, career, relationship, anything. So if there is something which is, our attention is somewhere else, it's very difficult to be there. So what he said, like Steve Jobs or whatever, he's coming to a presentation, doing a remarkable job, but there must be something which is still on their mind. How do they dump that and be there completely? Is that what you're saying? Okay, now you guys are all presenters, tell me.
It's like we need to stay focused on our mind, right? Like whatever it is, it's like in the presentation you have to focus on the presentation, because if you don't focus on this, no other problem can be solved like during that presentation, right? So wait for the phones and calls. Like, you cannot call any other platform than that.
Focus. Yeah.
Beautiful. It's like if you don't focus, it's a radical choice, right? Rational choice. It's like if you don't focus on this one, you're gonna make a bad presentation and think about the consequences of that. The other side, if you do well, one thing is out of the list, right? And then in the, like, no matter what you are doing in the presentation, whatever financial problems, a relationship problem, any other problem, they will never get solved during that time. So because of that you wait to decide and decide. So that's how it works for me.
Very nice. Very nice. Did you get the answer? What to do? I got the answer. Okay. While she was saying something, it just struck my mind. Presentation, focus on the present. And this is not only true. What's your name?
Kalpa.
So Kalpa, it's not true only for making a presentation. You could be with a loud one in a family, but your mind is with your presentation tomorrow morning. You can't be with that loud one, because you're already in the Noesis Center. So this is not only for presenting. I think this is true for whatever you are doing, wherever you are doing. And these days, the whole talk in the entire globe is of mindfulness and leadership, mindfulness and parenting, mindfulness and relationship. What is mindfulness? You are completely here and now. And this is a practice. This is really a practice. It doesn't happen easily, because the mind has a capacity to wander. And it's an interesting thing. If a person speaks at, say, 100 words a minute, your mind has a capacity to go 4 to 5 times faster. So when somebody is talking to you, your child is talking to you, and you say, go on, but you are somewhere else. And the other person realizes you're not there. So the same thing, please appreciate, you are nowhere else, but you are here and now. And this is a practice. This honestly is a practice, which we normally now talk about as mindfulness practice. And I like what you said. It's a rational choice. I love this word. It's something which is so rational. If you're not here, how can you do a good job of whatever you're doing? You're in a bank writing a check. I don't like banking anyway. But if I'm in a bank, I'm thinking of something, I put a wrong zero or something, and I make a mess because I wasn't totally there. So this is applicable to everything. And while you're presenting, actually be in the present, and you will be much, much better off. Because then you can tackle the other thing, because you can't tackle both of them together.
So actually, I recently listened to a talk, following your, actually, and the inside. So it says that some people actually control their thoughts for some other people. Thoughts control them. That's actually practice that you control your mind, not thoughts control you. So it's very difficult, but for those successful people, they actually have a very actually wonderful focus, and they control the mind. What to say, what to think right now, and actually.
By the way, do you know how many actually I counted?
Who did actually? She did? Oh.
9.
So we start the counting game. Beautiful, you, in case you like this, I don't know. There's a book, Power of Now, by a person called Eckhart Tolle. Eckhart, T-O-L-H-E. So he had this amazing aha while he was going through a lot of anxiety and depression and all that. So one fine day, he suddenly realized, I'm not my thoughts. Because the thoughts make us nuts. And everybody gets nuts, all of us. And then he wrote this beautiful book. And then he has written many more. But Power of Now is a book, a little complex at moments. Or you can listen to him on YouTube. So the moment you are here, as she said, when you are aware, I just wanted to modify one word that Sadhana used. Don't control your thoughts. be mindful of your thoughts. When you know you are thinking something else and you're mindful, it's easy to come back here. But when you control and say, I don't want to think this, what you resist persists. So if you control your mind, thoughts, they will bombard you more. But be mindful of them and come back to the moment, whatever. Come back to your breath. That's the easiest practice. Come back to your breath and you'll be here. You can't be anywhere else. You are physically only here. Yeah? So we'll just stop with one little story. There was a sculptor is the person who makes it. So the sculptor was asked, how do you make such beautiful sculptures of elephants and this, whatever? And he said something very simple. He said, I remove what doesn't belong to the elephant. You know, elephant shape is there in the mind. What doesn't belong to the elephant, I just remove that wood, that part of the wood. And that's exactly what you do with your presentations. What doesn't belong there, remove it ruthlessly. And if you know it doesn't add value to my objective, to my audience, drop it. Even if you like that content. I mean, I like the slide. So yesterday while I was condensing all my slides on presentation, so I said, structuring, I think they'll benefit. This, I think they'll like. But I knew that I just have 1 hour. So I have to be very ruthless that my content I want to share. So do that. What doesn't belong there, throw it. And Winston Churchill, who was supposed to be a very good speaker, he used to stammer, but he practiced and he worked on it. So he was in an event where he wasn't supposed to speak that day. He was just a guest. And the event is about to be over, a dinner party, whatever. And they walk up to him and said, just a few words, sir, just a few words. He came up and he was amazing. So finally a person walked up and he said, you weren't supposed to speak. How did you speak so well? You know? So he said, whenever I go, wherever I go, there may be a possibility they'll ask me to speak. Because the stage of prime minister of a country, I always go prepared to some extent, depending on what the occasion is. Right? So for me today, what I want to leave back with you, prepare when you have to present. Be very clear at what the objective is. Put your material together in a way where it helps you and doesn't come in the way. Find a method to actually relax yourself. And remember, it isn't something that we are born with. So I couldn't express in my middle years. These days, I'm reasonably good at expressing. But nothing dramatic happened overnight. But I'm aware that what it takes. I still make errors. Not a big deal. I'm learning. I'm work in progress. And on that note, I wish each one of you an amazing journey of presenting, speaking in public and speaking in your own groups, small groups or big groups, and enjoying the process. It's not your speaking that you are. Speaking is only a skill. And skill is not you, who you actually are. Who you actually are, blessed. Okay? So thank you so much and namaste once again and God bless you.
Thank you. I know this was a great talk because I know they were really present.
They were, yes.
They were really present here, yeah.
I could make out. Most of you were present. Thank you so much for that.
I think that I saw on a web people introducing this, that book. I read them all, but today is different.
How?
Today is different in a way that, like, I read book, I collect this, that, everything, but not everything at the same time, but today you put everything in a very nice story, very flow, and then even though, like, I'm running my experiment on a server, I just have to listen to
it. Oh, you're doing some stuff that's cheating.
Okay. I'm just monitoring.
But you weren't here, honestly.
But it is hard for somebody to get attention from me when I'm working, and you did it, and that is very amazing.
I didn't realize why she's holding it on her lap, but you were totally here, I could make out. Thank you so much for your attention and your presence today. And thanks to Amit and his entire team to make it possible. Good luck with everything, okay?
Thank you.
Bye-bye.